Hi, this is Tom Rhodes. Please join me as I scour the four corners of the earth to bring you interesting and intelligent funny people who will enrich your life with wisdom and laughter. I'll take you to Europe, Australia, all over America. I might take you to the peaks of Machu Picchu, the canals of Amsterdam, the Great Wall of China, or the swamps of Florida, and certainly the many, many comedy clubs and comedy theaters all over the world. Come hang out with me and meet the many interesting people that pop up in my life as I travel the world as a stand-up comedian.
You're listening to Tom Rhodes Radio.
Karate kick, baby.
Rock and roll.
Hello, and welcome to Tom Rhodes Radio. Viva Vietnam! Hooray for Vietnam! I am speaking to you now in the city formerly known as Saigon. I'm in Ho Chi Minh City in the Caravelle Hotel, speaking to you now from room 1406. Wow, I fulfilled a pretty big bucket list dream of going on a motorcycle adventure tour in Vietnam yesterday. And did you see my crash? Have you seen the video yet? I posted it on everything. Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, everything there is. And wow, I am a lucky son of a bitch that I can speak sounds and words come out of my mouth and you can hear it right now. So wow, let's give you some backstory. This gig in Hanoi is run by this British guy named Dan Dockery. The first time I did Hanoi was 4 years ago, and I wanted, you know, I did Viva Vietnam for Comedy Central. I went there in September 1994, and 2014 was 20 years later, and I really wanted to go back. Hanoi was my favorite place, and through Minh Ha Pham, this female Vietnamese comedian from Hanoi. I met her in Hong Kong, and she told me about the gig in Hanoi and hooked me up with Dan. I went there in 2014, and I spent like a week in Hanoi. And Hanoi is amazing. It's like very colonial French. It's got tree-lined French boulevards. There's scooters and motorcycles and bicycles. It really retained the charm that I loved about it when I went there in 2014. I'm sorry, in 1994, when I went back in 2014. I thought Ho Chi Minh City really kind of developed capitalistic, very American. A lot of skyscrapers popped up, a lot of automobiles, kind of like the changes that I've watched happen in China over the last 20 years. And, you know, there's nothing wrong with prosperity. I just like that charming old village feel that Hanoi has. Like Amsterdam feels like a village, even though it's a city. So Dan Dockery, you know, I've been communicating with him. He's a really cool guy. I had originally planned that this podcast was going to be, you know, we were going to ride motorcycles up to the top of Tam Dao Mountain, which we did yesterday. I'm about to tell you all about it. So I brought my recording device, and I wanted to interview him and talk about this motorcycle journey. But they're building shit everywhere up there. So it was like saws and hammer jacks and hammers hammering. It was noisy as shit. And I had just had my wreck 10 minutes earlier. So, you know, it's interesting. If you've ever heard me tell the story about almost drowning in Thailand, I say those words that there's nothing like almost dying to make you really appreciate living. So imagine how great I felt yesterday after my motorcycle crash. I don't want to, you know, it wasn't that severe. But the whole day was exhilarating in that it was terrifying. And my adrenaline was pumping. You know, when you're on a motorcycle, you know, like when you're in a car, your mind can wander, and it's okay. But when you're on a motorcycle, man, you have to be laser focused. It's like a video game, but you only have one life. And so I met Dan Dockery the last time I was here, and when I was in Hanoi, and he drove me all around in his motorcycle. I call him like the Indiana Jones of England. He's British, but unlike a lot of, I know I have listeners in London, so try not to get offended, but hopefully you'll know what I'm talking about. A lot of English people are whingers. They complain. I've done so many tours in Asia, comedy tours with English guys, and like they couldn't eat the local food. They had to go to like a British pub to get, you know, a shepherd's pie or bangers and mash. How come there's no mushy peas at the Vietnamese pho restaurant? Things like that. But Dan Dockery, he's really a badass, man. He's been living in Hanoi for 20 years. He's got his own restaurant called Highway 4. He started his own whiskey distillery, of course, with Vietnamese investors. Vietnam, like Thailand, I don't think foreigners can own property or go fully into business by themselves. So he's got a new location now called The Standing Bar. And he put me up at the, he puts the comedians up at the Intercontinental Hotel, which is swank. And, you know, the great thing about doing these Asia tours that I, you know, they usually put you in 5-star hotels, and then you've got these big, magnificent breakfast buffets, and it's hard not to be a complete pig at these breakfast buffets. They're so wonderful. Like, yeah, I'll have an omelet and some bacon and croissants covered in honey, and sure, why not a donut? And anyway, so Dan, he originally, when he came to Vietnam, he gave motorcycle tours out of Hanoi into northern Vietnam. And he told me when I came back, he would take me on a motorcycle journey. So that's why I came back. And, you know, he picks me up yesterday or 2 days ago to go do the gig. He's got a new location. It's called The Standing Bar. And it's on this beautiful lake. And this lake is actually the lake that John McCain was shot down in. Anti-aircraft, Dan Dockery told me when he picked me up on the motorcycle the other day, he said that anti-aircraft that day had shot down like 20 planes. And if you don't know the story, John McCain landed in this lake in the middle of Hanoi, and, you know, America's at war with them, and all these soldiers and townspeople surrounded the lake, and people swam out there and got him, and they beat the shit out of him and kicked him and beat him all the way to the prison, otherwise known as the Hanoi Hilton, and he was there for however many years. And that's a courageous story in its own right. He's being beaten and tortured, and at one point they were going to let him leave, and then he said he didn't want to leave until his brothers were all released. So he decided to, he ended up staying for like 2 or 3 years extra, being beaten and tortured, because he's, you know, a stand-up guy like that. And I respect John McCain now because, I mean, I respected him for doing that, but also because he's the only Republican who's standing up to Donald Trump and calling him on bullshit, him and that other guy from Arizona, which I forget his name. So the gig 2 nights ago was at the Standing Bar, and It's right on this lake that John McCain was shot down in, which now they've got these swan paddle boats. Like, if you go downtown Orlando, Florida, the Lake Eola is the centerpiece of downtown Orlando, and that's the one charming thing about Orlando. They've got these swan paddle boats. So this lake is full of these swan paddle boats. So the gig was great. A few expat local, you know, it was an Australian guy, a British guy, an American girl, woman, rather, punk rock with tattoos, really cool girl and woman. And anyway, I was kind of hoping that the guy that opened for me in 2014, when I was there in 2014, Minha Pham opened for me, female comedian, who got me, was the reason that I came back to Hanoi. But this young 19-year-old comedian from Hanoi opened the show, and if you've never heard me tell this story, I really wanted to see the guy again because he had been doing stand-up comedy for 6 months when he opened for me, and he told me before the show that Eddie Murphy, specifically Eddie Murphy Delirious, was his comedy inspiration, and he wanted to be the Eddie Murphy of Vietnam. So he had the experiences of a 19-year-old guy living in Hanoi, but he delivered everything like Eddie Murphy in Delirious with the red leather suit. If you can imagine him like prowling the stage, he's going, you know, when you're on your scooter and your girl is on the back and some dude comes up next to you at the light and he's looking at your girl. So I really was hoping this guy was going to be there so I could see that maybe he had moved on to Eddie Murphy's Raw special. But he wasn't there. Dan Dockery told me that that guy doesn't even do stand up anymore. So who knows what he's doing? So the gig was phenomenal. It was in the upstairs area, and expats, half Vietnamese, English-speaking people. I did a lot of great stuff. I talked about when I first came to Vietnam in 1994, and we went to this restaurant that served cobra, and the waiter brings the cobra out, and I was told that there's restaurants that still do this in Vietnam. So this guy brings out this cobra, and he throws it on the ground, like just feet from us. And he smacked it on the nose, because apparently cobra tastes better if it's pissed off. So, like the blood is pumping through its body or something. And so the hood on this cobra lifted, and this, you know, it's you're in Vietnam, everything seems cinematic. It didn't really faze me that there was a cobra on the ground until the guy hit it on the nose and its hood went up and it made this noise and I about shit in my pants. And the cobra struck at the guy and the waiter like pulled back and then he grabbed the cobra by its throat as he came back in. And I thought, you know, they must go through a lot of waiters in this place. So the waiter murders the cobra right in front of you. He cuts it open. You got all these shot glasses on the table, and he pulls out the beating heart of this cobra. This was in Viva Vietnam that aired on Comedy Central, which I used to have on YouTube, but the bastards made me take it down because apparently Comedy Central owns the rights to it. So he drains the cobra blood into the shot glasses, and then they pour vodka in it, and then everybody does cobra blood and vodka shots, and the guest of honor gets the one with the cobra heart in it. And because I was the guest of honor, I was given that shot, and I said no thanks. And our guide said that you're gonna offend people if you don't drink the one with the cobra heart. And I said, I don't give a shit who I offend. I'm not eating a cobra heart. You know, how can I not eat my mom's candied yams at Thanksgiving if I have eaten a cobra heart? Oh, yeah? Well, you had a cobra heart in Vietnam. You're not going to eat my candied yams? So, anywho, it was it's great to be back in Vietnam. And since the last time I was here, I've been dreaming about coming back and going on this Vietnam motorcycle adventure. So let's run through my history with motorcycles real quick. First of all, yesterday in Vietnam was only the fourth time in my life I have ever driven a motorcycle. Let's just go through the Tom Rhodes motorcycle history. When I was 14 years old, living in Oviedo, Florida, this kid in my neighborhood, Nate Stout, Nate's dead now. He committed suicide, unfortunately. His parent, and it's weird that he committed suicide because his parents gave him whatever he wanted. He used to skateboard. He was one of the first kids I ever knew who skateboarded. They let him build a skateboard ramp in his driveway. He wanted a dirt bike motorcycle. They got him a dirt bike motorcycle. So the neighborhood that I grew up in Oviedo, Florida, is called Mead Manor. And now Oviedo has expanded. My charming little citrus village is now a highway exit. But Mead Manor is still small, it still retains its charming Hanoi qualities, if you will, tree-lined boulevards and whatnot. But there was a point where Division Street, right after, I think, Lisa Hostetler's house, there was one more house after Lisa Hostetler's house on Division Street, and then it became this dirt road. And there were fields on either side with like one cow in it. And now that's all like houses are back there and stuff. But so all the kids in the neighborhood were taking turns. Everybody was taking turns riding Nate Stout's motorcycle. And I had never been on a motorcycle before. And it was my turn. And, you know, they just told me, Nate told me what the gears were. And I was off. And I'm ripping. I wasn't that fast, but the mistake that I made was I used the handbrake. And the handbrake, you know, when you're holding the motorcycle, the little, what do you call it, a prong, a hand thing, you got your handle, and then there's the little, the one on the left hand is your shifter. You hold that in to shift gears with your left foot, and the little, whatever, stick, prong, shifter, on the right hand is your brake for the front wheel. So something happened and I gripped the brakes with my right hand and the front end of the motorcycle locked up and I went over the handlebars and I put my arms out to catch my fall and I screwed up I tore like a tendon in my right arm. And I ended up missing a year of baseball, and I loved baseball when I was 14. I was out for a season. You know, when you're 14, that kind of shit hurts. And I forget what the damage to his bike was. It was like $43 or something. And Nate was insistent that I pay it. And my only income at 14 was the dollar a day that my parents gave me for lunch. So 43 days, I went without lunch so I could give Nate a dollar every day until I had paid off whatever light had been broken on his dirt bike. Okay, so then I had not ridden a motorcycle since I was 14 years old until I was working for the Dutch travel show, You're in Travel, and I was in Peru, and we went to the Nazca Lines, and it's in the desert. The Nazca Lines, if you don't know about it, you should look it up. It's truly a marvel. They were not discovered until the 1920s when aircraft flew overhead and they saw these big carvings. Actually, they're stone formations that have been lined up, but they're like one is of a condor bird, another one is of a monkey. And then one looks like an astronaut, people think. A lot of people think that these are UFO landing strips. And I flew in a little plane above it, and it looks like UFO landing strips. And I fully believe that it could have been UFO landing strips. So we were filming for You're in Travel, the Dutch travel show. We were covering doing this highlight in Peru. We go to the Nazca Lines, one of my dreams in life since I saw the Leonard Nimoy show In Search Of and first saw these things. And it was a very un-Dutch moment because, you know, Dutch people are great workers and very rarely will there ever be a conflict with Dutch workers. I mean, it happens because it happened this day. The director and the producer got into an argument, these two females. And so they went off and talked in the van. And there's like an hour while they're working this out, and I'm bored, and we're in the desert. So I just start picking up baseballs, start picking up rocks, and I start throwing them like baseballs. And then way off in the distance, I see this motorcycle coming towards us. And it took, you know, 5-10 minutes before this motorcycle gets up to me and says to me, please don't throw those rocks. Those rocks are the Nazca lines. I could have ruined thousands of years of priceless antiquity. But the guy, there's a picture of me somewhere on this motorcycle. The German mathematician scientist who spent her life studying the Nazca lines, left money for the Nazca lines to be protected. Now they're somewhat protected by the government, but for many years, it was just, I forget, Maria something, I forget, because it says her name on the motorcycle gas tank. So I was talking to the guy, and I forget, it was like a little Honda 250 or something. It was kind of a small bike. This Peruvian guard of the Nazca lines. And he was a nice guy. He wasn't even pissed that I'm throwing the Nazca lines. And he let me get on his motorcycle and ride it. And so I got to ride his motorcycle around the Nazca lines. Of course, you know, there were little markers where not to go on the real Nazca lines that need to be protected. And that was one of the greatest thrills of my life, because I've had a fear of motorcycles my whole life because of this wreck that I had when I was 14. And so that was like a big thrill, as you can imagine. And then I did not ride a motorcycle again. The third time I rode a motorcycle was last summer in Holland, when Ashna and I were in Rotterdam visiting her family. And Ashna's brother teaches motorcycle lessons. So I told him I would really like to learn how to ride a motorcycle properly. So he took me out. I got the family free discount. And it was really great. He took me to this big empty parking lot where they teach people how to ride motorcycles in Rotterdam. So they can get ready for their motorcycle test to get their license. He sets up the cones. I went through all the, you know, the little test runs and weaving. And then he's got me, you know, going way to the other end of the parking lot and then coming and then slamming on the brakes. And that was cool. I could feel, you know, the bike lock up and do it properly and then, you know, not be thrown off because I'm standing on the right foot brake. If I was squeezing the handbrake at the same time. So, okay, so what? That was 8 months ago? I took the motorcycle lesson in Rotterdam. So, of course, Tom Rhodes, the moron that I am, I think, sure, that's enough practice to go on a motorcycle adventure tour. And it was kind of funny. Yesterday morning, I took a taxi over to Dan's apartment, and he's got his motorcycles in the bottom garage. And I told him, I said, remember, I'm a beginner, and you know, let's take it slow and easy and be very cautious. And you know, that was my intention yesterday. So that's my history with motorcycles leading up to now. So I think it was the motorcycle I was on yesterday, really cool bike, a Kawasaki 350, I think it was. Someone tweeted to me, Fred, listener, guy who lives in Seattle or Tacoma, who's come to see me when I've played up there. He was tweeting that he had that same bike in high school, and that it's called a Kawasaki Bighorn or something like that. But so I think it was like a Kawasaki 350. Not too big. I couldn't imagine those big, fat Harley hogs. And you see those people with the motorcycles, and they've got all the boxes on it and places for gear. And I always think, you know, you wanted a car. It was like a proper, nice dirt bike. The kind of bike you would want to go on a Vietnam motorcycle adventure with. So we're going out of Hanoi. Hanoi is very hectic traffic, and you're blending. You know, it's funny, when you go to Vietnam, there's this trick. I remember when I first came in 1994, and I did it again in 2014, where they say, you know, this never-ending traffic, and they say, well, to cross the road, just walk slowly out into it, and then all the, you know, motorcycles and mopeds and scooters and cars and bikes will just magically go around you, which they do. But when you're actually on a motorcycle, they pull out in front of you. And, you know, I'm trying to be slow and cautious. We get out of the city. I just looked it up before I started recording. So from Hanoi to the top of Tam Dao Mountain is a little over 45 miles. I had no idea that that's how far we went. So yesterday I drove 90 miles on a Kawasaki motorcycle. And it was intense. And we get out to the countryside, and then I'm following Dan. He's got his beautiful Vietnamese girlfriend on the back, you know, and you're, you know, the going there is like, I'm thinking, man, wow, this is great, and the freedom and the wind in my face. And we passed this like field, and it had about 30 water buffalo in it. And the water buffalo are the symbol of Vietnam. This symbol of Vietnam is like a water buffalo with a young boy playing a flute sitting on top of it. It's such a peaceful symbol. But the water buffalo is everything in Vietnam. So here's like a field of like 30 of them, and they're slogging through this mud, these big tank animals. And, you know, if I'm in a car, like, I'd pull out my camera and snap a shot. And on the motorcycle, you can't do that. And, you know, later when we stopped for gas, I told Dan, I said, you know, if we happen to pass a field full of water buffalo, and it looks like it might be the greatest National Geographic photo of all time, can we please stop? And he said, sure. So then we get back on the bikes, and then we drive, I don't know, 2 or 3 miles, and then there was like some skinny, shitty-looking water buffalo. And he stopped, and I took a photo. But it wasn't the one that I was looking for. He got lost a couple times looking for the gas station. We pulled through these little, these some tiny villages, which is really charming. You know, like the only, it's like being on a horse in the Old West, almost. You know, like white guys riding into town on motorcycles. And we're driving out there. I'm laser focused. I'm trying to be as careful as I possibly can. And I've got all these thoughts of like, man, this is going to be my new thing. I'm going to like start, man, I'm thinking, I'm going to buy a motorcycle. And I'm thinking, man, you know, I always thought those Royal Enfields were cool. Like a small one. Like, well, like the one I had yesterday was great. Or a little Triumph or something like that. I'm thinking, man, this is going to be my new thing. I'm going to be like, you know, like I always thought there's a movie I loved, you know, you had The Outsiders, which was a classic of my teen years, the S.E. Hinton book, but also an S.E. Hinton book that I always loved was called Rumblefish. And Mickey Rourke plays the motorcycle boy, and he goes out to California. He comes back to Oklahoma. Matt Dillon is his little brother. And he says, Matt Dillon asks him, did you see the ocean? And he said, no, California got in the way. And, you know, when I'm like 14, 15, sitting there with my broken arm, not playing baseball, watching this thinking, man, that's a cool thing to say. And then at the end of Rumblefish, the movie ends with, you know, Mickey Rourke gets killed and Matt Dillon takes his brother's motorcycle and he drives it all the way from Oklahoma to California. And the last shot of the movie is him like pulling the motorcycle up right next to the ocean. So, you know, you got Easy Rider, just all these great symbolic movies of motorcycles. Oh, I'll tell you another thing that went through my head a lot yesterday was I felt like Steve McQueen. And in The Magnificent Seven, you know, they're prisoners of war in World War II, and Steve McQueen steals a German soldier's motorcycle, and there's that famous scene where he jumps over the barbed wire fence. So yesterday, I felt like Steve McQueen, and that is why a red-blooded man of any stripe would want to ride motorcycles in Vietnam in the first place. So I'm thinking, fuck, this is so cool, man. And I'm thinking of future motorcycle journeys I want to go on. I'm like, because Dan Dockery, last year, he took 4 months off and he drove all over South America. He went there and bought a motorcycle, and him and like three other buddies bought motorcycles in Chile. And then they drove through Argentina, up through Patagonia. They went to Peru, said they had to bribe the soldiers at the border to get in. And they took this magnificent journey all over South America and then sold the motorcycles in Colombia and flew back to their respective homes. So I'm thinking, fuck, man, this is going to be the new Tom Rhodes thing. I'm going to, like, every year or two, I'm going to plan some big motorcycle adventure. I'll do South America. Maybe one day I'll drive, like, from Texas all the way through Mexico, down the West Coast, through Veracruz and all that stuff. Maybe, you know, my friend Dave Fulton in England is always talking about taking a motorcycle journey through India. Last year when I played in Oslo, he wasn't a doorman. He was like the head of security or the manager or something at the club Latter in Oslo. Guy told me he told me his father's from a small town in Italy. And he said every summer he and his father ride motorcycles from Oslo down through Germany. And then they go through Austria. And then they go through Switzerland, over the Alps, into Italy. And then they drive all the way down through Italy to his father's little village. And I thought, wow, Jesus, that sounds like one of the greatest motorcycle adventures of all time. So I'm thinking, this is going to be my new thing, the Tom Rhodes motorcycle adventure thing. All these thoughts are going through my mind driving to Tam Dao Mountain. So everything's flat, going there for, I don't know, 35 of these miles. And then we stopped. We were going to go to this bear sanctuary. Vietnam is now, they're protecting the bears. We were going to, but it was closed. And then somewhere right next to the bear sanctuary was like a, I wouldn't even call it a cafe. It was just like a, maybe some people lived there and they had their garage door open. And they had little plastic chairs, children's size. And we sat there, some kind of fruit I've never heard of. And I can't remember the name of it. The little black kind of berry sized things. It was like four or five of them in the bottom. And it was delicious. Super hot. I'm covered in sunblock 50, you know. Don't want to get yelled at by the missus that my honky skin got fried in the sun. So yeah, we have our nice little beverages, and then we're going up this winding mountain road. And is total construction going on in this mountain road. And let me have a little sip of my coffee. hot Vietnamese coffee. You know that Vietnam is the world's second biggest producer of coffee? I didn't know that. If you Google amazing facts about Vietnam, that and many other things will pop up. You never should lose your patience with people in Vietnam because they don't like to lose face. So a lot of white Westerners come to Asia and get all pissed off and hot and bothered and snippy with people, and that is the wrong thing to do in Vietnam. But if you think about it, it's the wrong thing to do anywhere. So don't be a dick, as Jesus used to say. So, all right. I know the suspense is killing you. Let's get to this. So I guess they're trying to widen the road. That's what they're trying to do. They're trying to widen this mountain road. And there was lots of big trucks. There was a couple times where, you know, there were the clusters of these big dump trucks, and there's lots of dirt and gravel on the road. And Dan Dockery, he's been living in Vietnam for 20 years and giving motorcycle tours, and he doesn't give a fuck. He's trying to pass these things. And I'm like, fuck that. I'm in no hurry. I don't want to die, and I want to be completely cautious. So I'm sitting back, and then he would pull over and wait for me, and I was like, hey, brother, there is no hurry, and there's no reason for me to try and maneuver 1 foot of space between a big dump truck and the edge of the road and where there's a gutter. I mean, who knows how many Vietnamese people still have a grudge against Americans or French people for trying to oppress them. Who knows what the fuck? But there's no reason for me to try and pass a cluster of 3 or 4 dump trucks on a one-lane friggin' mountain road. So I'm being very cautious, going up this road, trying to stay away from the edges. And I'll tell you a little secret. I forgot to tell Dan Dockery this, but because of my accident when I was 14 years old, where I slammed that front brake by squeezing my right hand, I did not use that front wheel brake once yesterday. Well, maybe lightly once. But I used the back wheel brake the whole time. And, you know, no one respects the fool. No one respects the flame like the fool who was badly burned, as Pete Townsend said in, what song is that? Slit Skirts? Love that song. So anyway, we're going up the mountain, and it's coincidentally enough, Dan Dockery, he had a little stand on the front of his handlebars. He put his iPhone and he started filming me 35 seconds before I crashed. So if you look at the video, or if you haven't already seen it, take a peek at it. This winding mountain road, I'm handling it like a champ. And I felt like Steve McQueen, and I'm doing great. I'm avoiding the edges, and as laser focused as I was, I got too close to an edge of sand and gravel, and before I knew it, the bike slid out from under me, and I landed. It's funny because you see the bike, the back wheel slides right, goes down. There's like kind of a gutter along the road, or ditch, whatever you want to call it. And so I flew off the friggin' bike, and it's great. I landed on my right shoulder and my right elbow. And then I put my left hand out. I had no choice. And so I lost a little tiny bit of skin on my right hand, on my little fat panda bear pads on the bottom. And then the biggest damage is on my, I lost a big swatch of skin on my right elbow, and it's all road rash, raspberry. I lost a But it's like only like the first or second. It wasn't like meat was ripped off my body, and then my right shoulders got scratches, and you know the T-shirt I was wearing was not even ripped, and it was a miracle. I jumped up instantly, and I was in such a great mood that I crashed, and yet I was still alive. And like it, and I instantly start doing like kind of stretches with my arms. Fuck, I'm doing it now as I speak. And my right shoulder and my arm is sore. And, but I didn't break anything. And it's a miracle that I didn't break an arm or my wrist. You know, unfortunately, the bracelet that the comedians of Mongolia gave me broke. And so I looked at all the pieces. I found all the pieces. This comedian in Mongolia, he made me a card with all the symbols that he had put on it, what they meant. It was a little lion's head for courage. There was a Spartan helmet for strength in battle. This specter, this Indian symbol means like wisdom. And then there was the evil eye thing. Who knows? Maybe the bracelet saved me. But the beautiful watch that Russell Peters gave me for my birthday was not broken. This recording device, this is the first recording I've done since the accident, was in the backpack I'm wearing, as was my photo camera. And it was not broken. So, hallelujah. One of the front turn signal lights on the motorcycle was broken, and I'm sure that cost $43, and Dan never mentioned it, so I don't have to give him my lunch money. But everything's, the bike worked fine other than the turn signal light being broken. We get up to Tam Dao Mountain, and we went instantly to a first aid doctor. Where's a doctor? And so the doctor cleans me up. I posted pictures of that. I'm like, you know, covered in dirt on my right side. And, you know, instantly this guy puts disinfectant on me. This is like 10 minutes after the accident. We're up at the little village of Tam Dao Mountain. And it couldn't have worked out better. I mean, it really could have been a shitty instance. So, boom. When we drive our motorcycles around this little mountain area. It was funny, we stopped, his girlfriend, Dan Dockery's girlfriend, stops to buy chestnuts. You see, they're doing hot chestnuts everywhere in Vietnam. That's a big thing. So she wanted some hot chestnuts. And these like five or six Vietnamese guys come up, Where are you from? Can we? And they want to take photos with me and Dan, like they had never seen white people before. Or like we were movie stars or something. So they go, where are you from? I said, Los Angeles. And they didn't understand. I said, California. They didn't understand. And I said, Hollywood. And then they went, oh, Hollywood. Very great. And I took photos with these guys. And anyway, then we stopped at this chalet-looking building and I had a coffee and some water. And that's where I originally wanted to do this week's podcast, but there's hammering and nails and all this shit and saws. So we go back down the mountain. We got just enough time to get back before we're going to get back to Hanoi at sunset. And man, I'm like super cautious going down the mountain. And not a problem. Everything's great going down the mountain. And then I think it's probably like 4 o'clock, 4:30 when we hit the flatlands where we got whatever it is, 30 miles, 35 miles back to Hanoi. And it's at the end of the day. And man, it was like all hell broke loose on the highway. People are driving fast. And apparently in Vietnam, red lights are just a suggestion. So we're in the countryside and we're driving and we've got the right of way. We've got the green light. And then motherfuckers are pulling out from the side streets and like driving straight across like it was a suicide death wish. So, and there was a couple of times, there was two young guys on a motorcycle who pulled out right in front of me. And that's when I used the handbrake. That was the one time, and the foot brake at the same time. And I slammed the brakes and skidded. And I was like, motherfucker. And I almost hit these guys. And that could have been like a real fucked up injury. And then like, they just smiled at me and laughed. I'm like, what the fuck? And it was like so stupid of them to just pull out into, I wasn't by myself, there were other people. They'd like pulled out into all this oncoming, flowing traffic. And then there was another instance where we're like 20 miles from Hanoi and there's lots of traffic going in both directions. And when I say highways, it's not highways like we have in America or Europe that have like a median or guardrails. There's like, I think, two lanes on either side. Getting closer to Hanoi, it was three lanes on either side. There was one time where like a small green truck, this guy just did this fucking U-turn and he pulled out in front of us, in front of Dan and me. And that took total alertness to keep from wrecking, as did the cluster of 10 or 20 other motorcycles and scooters that were traveling with us. And then like, you know, and Dan said when we were having the coffee at the top of the mountain, he said, you know, it's a good thing you weren't driving too fast because speed kills. Speed's the real danger when you're riding a motorcycle. So at one point, it seemed like he totally forgot that I was following him. And I don't know what, because the speedometer's like in kilometers. So I had to do like 70, 80 kilometers an hour, whatever the fuck that is. I think it's like 50 miles an hour. Which on a bike out, you know, that's pretty much ripping it. And he was way the fuck out in front of me. And I'm trying to keep up with him. And I'm thinking, fuck, I broke my iPhone. I dropped it when I was changing planes in Hong Kong. And there's no Wi-Fi signal out there anyway, but I have no idea how to get back to Hanoi. I don't speak Vietnamese. I'm in the countryside. I don't know. I guess if I wrecked or got lost, I could ask people to point me in the direction of Hanoi. I don't know, but I'm trying to keep up with the guy. And there was a couple of times where these people on side streets, you know, this one girl on a moped fucking just pulled out. And that was hairy. Anyway, so I'm thinking, I can't wait to get back to Hanoi and relieve myself of this fucking motorcycle. And it's funny because on the drive up to the mountain, I'm thinking, this is going to be my new thing. I'm going to buy a motorcycle. I'm going to go on these adventures. On the way back, I'm thinking to myself, I never want to ride another motorcycle as long as I live. This is the most terrifying fucking experience. So finally we get back into Hanoi and it's the end of the day. And so there's, you know, buses and motor coaches and trucks. And it's like everyone has got off work. Everyone can't wait to get home. It's like there's no traffic rules whatsoever. Like, you know, you got a green light and fucking now it's tons of people shooting across from the cross streets. And we get into Hanoi and it was super hectic. It was just so terrifying. And I don't know how I didn't wreck again. I got really lucky that my only incident yesterday was this one little spill that I took. And, you know, I think people who ride regularly take spills like that hundreds and hundreds of times. I'm so lucky. You know, my fucking shoulders hurts. It's sore. I'll try and take a picture of my elbow and put it on the Patreon thing so that our Golden Buddha supporters or anybody who sponsors the podcast and can access the Patreon website, you can see my my injury, my skinned up arm. I got really fucking lucky. And so we make it back to Hanoi at sunset. We stopped on this, you know, the nice thing about Hanoi is all these lakes. There's the tree-lined boulevard. There's the lake that John McCain went down in, which I think that's West Lake, or I don't know. But there's this massive lake, and there's a bike, motorcycle, moped path all around this massive lake. And we pulled up onto this green grassy area. I would say park, but it wasn't a park because people don't... There's a lot of garbage people throw on the ground in Vietnam. So we pulled up and it's sunset and we watched the sunset on this lake. And man, that felt like Matt Dillon reaching the Pacific Ocean at the end of Rumblefish. I was so happy that I got back. So now it's dark. It just got dark in Hanoi, which is a really nice time. And we go through the city. We're going to go eat dinner. I want to go to the restaurant where Barack Obama ate with Anthony Bourdain. It's this special Vietnamese dish. You can Google the restaurant. I can't pronounce it, and I forget what the dish is called. So we went by, we drove by Ho Chi Minh's mausoleum, and then there's this other lake. There's this great story from Hanoi hundreds of years ago. It's interesting, too, because, you know, the American government didn't, you know, they were worried about the domino effect of all of Southeast Asia going communist. But if they had studied history, the Vietnamese have had many wars, hundreds of wars with the Chinese. And China's tried to take over Vietnam many times. There's this great, in the war museum in Hanoi that I went to in 2014, I saw this beautiful mural of it. But I read about this story in 1994 when I first came to Vietnam. Hundreds of years ago, the Chinese was going to invade. They invaded Vietnam and they wanted to take over the country. So all these Chinese ships are coming down the Mekong River. The Vietnamese had cut down trees and sharpened the ends of them like big spears, and they put them in the river, spikes facing where the ships would come down, and then the ships hit the spikes, and then all the ships sank, and the Vietnamese sat on the edges and picked them off and killed them with arrows and threw spears at them and murdered them all. You know, they're peaceful-looking, unassuming people, but the Vietnamese are proven badass warriors and will fuck people up. So there's this story. I forget the guy's name, but I call it Turtle Lake. It's like 300 years ago, China had invaded Vietnam, and I forget this warrior's name. A turtle came up from the bottom of this lake. It's this beautiful lake in the center of Hanoi. And the turtle had a sword in its mouth. And the turtle gives the sword to this Vietnamese warrior. And then he killed thousands and thousands of Chinese and drove them out of Vietnam. It's an amazing story. The last time I was here, I bought a little... last time I was in Hanoi, I found a little turtle souvenir with the sword in his mouth carved out of marble or some kind of stone that I have in my apartment that looks like a National Geographic gift shop. So we go to the restaurant that Obama, so we went past that beautiful lake, the Ho Chi Minh Mausoleum. We make it to this restaurant, and I'm exhausted at this point. It was, what, like 7 o'clock, 7:30, something like that. We go in and we eat. There's three levels to this restaurant. We go up on the second level, and there is a table and two chairs with the bowls and the dishes on it, and it's covered in a glass box, like a museum piece. And that is the table and chair where Obama and Anthony Bourdain sat when they visited this place. And apparently this place is making tons of money now because of this historic event that happened there. So that was kind of cool. We're sitting like, you know, a table over, very close to it. I had the dish that that they had, that the restaurant's famous for. It was delicious. And then we drive the bikes very slowly and carefully. I'm in a cluster of hundreds of bikes and motorcycles and mopeds, and it's just amazing how everyone, you know, clusters together and you're almost bumping into people. And somehow I safely got this motorcycle back to Dan's apartment, and then we go down this ramp, and underneath the apartment building is the moped, scooter, motorcycle parking garage. And you know, I with the pass, I get let in. I park the motorcycle. I put the stand down and I turned it off, and I got off the motorcycle and I jumped up and down with joy because I had survived. One of my favorite pictures that I posted yesterday also is when we got to that lake at sunset. And I got my fist raising, and I'm on the motorcycle. I'm raising my fist, and I've got my bandage on my boo boo. So that was my big adventure yesterday. And then I very happily took a taxi back to the Intercontinental Hotel, and I do not foresee a motorcycle trip in a third world country, or Jesus, in Los Angeles. I couldn't imagine how people drive through cars. You know, you can drive through the, when cars are in the lanes, you can cut through them. And I also thought about Evel Knievel yesterday. What a fucking lunatic. As difficult and focused as you have to be to ride a motorcycle, to then decide to jump buses and things, just absolute lunacy. So I survived. I'm in Vietnam now. I flew this morning from Hanoi to Ho Chi Minh City. And now my show is 2 hours from now. I'm looking at the clock. And so I walked around for an hour. I like Ho Chi Minh City, not as much as Hanoi. I walked over to the Rex Hotel, which is where I stayed in 1994 when I first came here to film Viva Vietnam. And we would come back from filming all day. They have a rooftop garden bar restaurant, and I went up there and took a peek at it. Now I'm looking out my window. I can see the Mekong River in the not too far distance. And I can see down at the swimming pool. I'm at the Caravelle Hotel. You know, it's funny, there's a, I was thinking about Vietnam songs from the war. There was this Charlie Daniels song, Still in Saigon. Yeah, I remember like Bruce Springsteen's Born in the USA was a great song about the Vietnam War and a guy coming back to America. Everybody thought that was such a patriotic song, Born in the USA, but it's actually critical of the American government for, you know, the Vietnam War, and then abandoning the soldiers who fought it. And so just that, I guess from the popularity of the Born in the USA, there was a lot of songs about, it was like, I remember in the 80s, then all of a sudden all these songs about the Vietnam War would come out. And I remember Charlie Daniels had this song, Still in Saigon. And I went on YouTube to listen to it. I thought, oh man, that would be a good song to end the podcast with. It is such a shitty, overproduced 80s song with these, like, oh my God, it's just, it's such a shitty song. I will not bother you with it. But I'd say without a doubt, my favorite Vietnam War song is The Clash, Straight to Hell, about children in Vietnam who had been fathered by American servicemen who were left behind after the Americans pulled out. I always loved that song. I saw The Clash at the Sanford Orlando High Life Fronton in whatever year that was, on the Combat Rock Tour. Or I think it was called the Straight to Hell Tour. It was the Combat Rock album. And I bought the very cool Clash t-shirt that it was olive green, and it had a skull and crossbone on it, on the chest, and on the chest it said Straight to Hell, and on the back it said The Clash with the tour dates. And I thought that was such a cool concert t-shirt, and my religious mother threw it in the trash because it said Straight to Hell on it. Oh, hey, so I wanted to mention this also. When I got back to the hotel last night, the Intercontinental in Hanoi, room 108, for those of you keeping track, I was so tired and so exhausted and very sore on my shoulder and my arm. I'm lying down, I'm trying to sleep, and I was exhausted. I thought, I'm going to go out any minute. So I'm lying there trying to sleep, and then all of these flashbacks would come into my mind of the entire day of, like, you know, an old woman on a bike pulling in front of me, that green truck that did the U-turn, the young girl in the moped who shot straight across the road, and I had to lock up the fucking brakes. So I thought, oh, wow. You know, I grew up obsessed with the Vietnam War because of my father flew helicopters in Vietnam and was shot down. And you always heard the thing about soldiers having flashbacks. So I thought, oh, that's interesting. Now I finally got my Vietnam flashback moments. You know, and another thing, I went to the over to the Rex Hotel, and then I walked around the area here. Like, right in front of the Caravelle Hotel is the opera house, built by the French. And I was thinking about it, you know, when I did Viva Vietnam, September 94, we filmed it, and it aired April 1995 to coincide with the 20-year anniversary of the end of the Vietnam War. And then I came back to Vietnam in 2014 to do some stand-up comedy gigs, and that was 20 years after that. And I remember Patrick Hansen was our sound man for Viva Vietnam, and he had actually served in the Vietnam War. I think here in Vietnam they call it the American War. Depends on your perspective. So it's just amazing how 20 years is not that long ago. When you're young, it seems like an eternity. I remember in the 80s, thinking that the 60s were fucking, wow, that was like ancient history. And then after doing Viva Vietnam in 1994 and then coming back in 2014, I was like, wow, that's perspective on, you know, how short of a distance of time that is, and how, you know, people who actually served in the war are still alive, and that that memory and the reality of that really wasn't that long ago. So anyway, something to think about. Put that in your tea and stir it. So, okay, it seems like it's getting a little dark outside. And let's see, is that it? Wow, so much is happening. I'm in Ho Chi Minh City. Tomorrow I fly to Manila. And then this weekend, Friday night, I have a show in Singapore. And then next week, I'm in Hong Kong. So, my favorite thing in Vietnam is, especially in Hanoi, the people have bikes with everything. They're selling things. They're just, it's amazing. People like moving trees, aquariums full of fish, and even on these scooters and motorcycles. You know, not only do they observe no road rules and pull out in front of you, people are carrying everything. And there's like families of six on a moped or a motor scooter, you know, carrying a ladder, an aquarium full of fish, 16 cases of Coca-Cola. Whoever said Asians couldn't drive obviously never came to Vietnam. Another interesting fact about Vietnam is that the currency is the dong, D-O-N-G. And that cracks me up. I know it's childish, but try and keep a straight face when you ask a shopkeeper how many dong you want for that. Times are tight, son. You really got to stretch that dong. So 100 American dollars is over 2 million dong. So I've been here. This is day 3 in Vietnam. I'm in Nam, man. And I've checked my bank balance at an ATM machine twice just to see this fucking massive number. I am rich. I'm dong rich. It's just amazing that $100 is over 2 million dong. And it's a very good feeling in Vietnam to check your bank balance at the ATM machine, because even if you don't have a lot of money, it looks like you're loaded. You're dong rich. Oh, hey, and then I'm going to be opening for John Cooper Clarke in Los Angeles, April 17th. I don't know where the venue is. They might add a show on April 18th. You know, he's John Cooper Clarke, English punk rock poet. I've had him on the show before. And then I go to Austin, Texas to do the Moon Tower Festival, April 19th through 21st. Yeah. All kinds of good shit coming up, people. I hope things are great in your life. I'm happy to be alive. There's nothing like almost breaking a collarbone and twisting a wrist to make you really appreciate that you have a show in Ho Chi Minh City tonight. And there's just a little discomfort on your elbow rubbed up against the shirt. So that's it. I love you all. And Viva Vietnam. And hooray for humanity. Shalom, amigos. E, amigas.
Steel mills rust. Whoa. clear as winter ice. This is your paradise. There ain't no need for ya. There ain't no need for ya. Go straight to hell, boys. Go straight to hell, boys. Wanna join in a chorus of the Amerasian blues when it's Christmas out in Ho Chi Minh City? Kitty say Papa, 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 Papa Sam, take me home. See me got photo, photo, photograph of you and Mama, Mama, Mama Sam. Sam, let me tell you about your blood bamboo kid.
It ain't Coca-Cola, it's rice.
Straight to hell, boy. Go straight to hell, boy. Go straight to hell, boy. Go straight to hell, boy. Oh, Papa Sam, please take me home. Oh, Papa Sam, everybody, they wanna go home. So Mama Sam says, wanna play mind crazed banjo on the druggy drag ragtime USA in Parkland International. Hey, junkie dumb USA, where pro came proves the purest rock man groove and rat poison. The volatile Molotov says, straight to hell. Can you cough it up loud and strong? The immigrants, they wanna sing all night long. It could be anywhere, most likely could be any frontier, any hemisphere. No man's land. There ain't no asylum. King Solomon, he never lived round here. Straight to hell, boy. Go straight to hell, boy. Go straight to hell, boy.